This is Red Wings Live. It's presented by Arby's. Happy Friday. Welcome inside the Fox Sports Detroit studios. Welcome to Red Wings Live. I'm John Keating with the Cape Crusaders, Darren Elliott and Chris Osgood. There was all kinds of concern when the Wings went through that gruesome stretch. It's the same question we've asked ourselves about Rick Astley. What were we thinking? Two straight wins, Ozzy, and the smiles are back.
Yeah, for sure. And the key to this whole thing is to continue it. And I like what Jeff Blashill said, the process. And that's what they have to continue to do here tonight in Toronto. I really like the way their defense has been playing the last two games. They've not only been physical, they've jumped up in the play. Their first pass out of their zone has been great. And really, with this Detroit team all year, I think that's where it's going to start and finish. Yes, the goalies have been great. They're going to be a big part of this moving forward. But if that defense can play up their potential even better, they can go a long ways.
And they have to really be ready for a hard-working team. The Toronto Maple Leafs are playing pretty consistently. They're hard to play against, so you're going to have your best effort up ice in the offensive third.
Yeah, Mike Babcock has said that he likes the way that his team has played the last couple of games. We shall see tonight. The evening in Toronto is known as the Hall of Fame game. A bit of scheduling finagling to have the Wings in town to play the Leafs because of whom is being inducted into the Hall on Monday night. But it's a weekend of hockey heroes. Trevor Thompson is there with more on two of the Wings greats to be so honored. Trev, good evening.
Good evening to you as well, Keats, and certainly Chris Pronger, Phil Housley, and Angela Ruggiero are going into the Hall of Fame as players. But the two you're talking about, Sergei Fedorov and Nicklas Lidström, two all-time greats as far as the Red Wings are concerned, now immortalized in the Hockey Hall of Fame. Today they received their Hall of Fame rings. These two were drafted in the same year, came into this organization, were roommates together for several seasons, won Stanley Cups together, and now we'll take this next step together, and there's certainly a lot of pride involved in that for both of them as they reflect on one another.
It's very special going in with Sergei, especially, you know, we played together for so many years, we share a lot of good memories, and we were roommates for a while, so it makes it even more special going in with a former teammate. The speed he brought to the game, the way he could skate full speed and still stick handling and dribble through guys. Not many guys could do that with his speed. And he was such a dynamic player. It was fun to watch. He could do things that you kind of look back and think, how did he do that?
Just all those memories all of a sudden just coming in place, and you just finally start realizing that we were good team, we were good roommates. Sometime our room had 7 points in one game. That was amazing too. But we didn't make a big deal, obviously, out of it. We just high five and just went to bed and rest and get ready for the next game. So it just were easy but hard road at the same time. But I hope Nick would say the same thing. We try to help each other as much as we can. We play a lot. We play a lot of different hockey situations. We experience a lot. We lose a lot. We lost a lot, but we'll be able to get up and get it done. In other words, win the Stanley Cup.
Both those guys, Fedorov and Lidström, accepted their rings this afternoon with the same humility and grace that they played with their entire careers. Now they'll look forward to Monday evening when they are officially inducted to the Hall of Fame. Those plaques will be in the Great Hall among the others, and the Red Wing greats included in that, as will they be after Monday. Keats, back to you inside the studio for now.
All right, Trev, thanks. We'll rejoin you at the Air Canada Center in just a moment. What's staggering is that it looks like Nick and Sergei could each still be playing. They're each 45. Lidström, perhaps the greatest defenseman ever. Fedorov played some on the blue line. In fact, Scotty Bowman once said that for a six-week span, he might have been the best defenseman in the league. More on those guys a little bit later in the show, but let's talk of present-day Red Wings. And in winning two straight, the Wings' blue line has been better, and Nicklas Kronwall challenged himself to be better than he'd been playing.
And like he always has, he stepped up to his own personal challenge. Part of it, though, he's been playing with Brendan Smith, but the difference has been lessening the load. He played over 30 minutes and then over 25 minutes and was minus four in those two games prior. The last two games, right at 20 minutes, plus one shots on goal. So less has been more for Nick Kronwall. I think there's a good message there. The coach recognized that I could get more out of him, but if he doesn't have to play against those big, heavy bodies of the opposition's top players.
Yeah, absolutely. I think the key to that, which is kind of underrated, is Brendan Smith playing with him. Yeah. Brendan Smith is a quick player. He's fast. He has some offensive touch to his game. And he needs to be with Cromwell as well. I think that's their best pairing right now. Smitty's playing his best. Brendan Smith is playing his best hockey of the year right now with Cromwell. But I think Cronin as well is benefiting from playing with Smith. Smith is a lot better than he's been given credit for this season. I think his last two games he played very good. I expect him to continue doing that same thing tonight.
All right, well, the blue line is evolving. Kyle Quincy was perhaps the Wings' best on the blue line through the first few weeks of the season, but he was knocked out of the lineup by a concussion. When the cobwebs cleared, he realized he probably should have some work done on a troublesome ankle, and that hurts because if he does, in fact, have surgery, it's probably going to take him out of the lineup for 6 weeks.
This isn't good news. He was arguably the Red Wings' best defenseman when he was in the lineup playing, and an ankle injury for a defenseman is not good. The thing a defenseman has to do is they got to pivot. They got to deal with speed of the forwards and the opposition team when your ankle isn't at 100%, and it can't be when he comes back when he's out for 6 weeks. This isn't a good injury. I'm hoping he really works hard in rehab and gets back because, you know, this guy kind of goes under the radar as well. He was real solid defenseman, good defensively. He's a big body, plays solid in front of the Red Wings net. He's going to be missed back there.
He and DeKeyser were the shutdown pair, if you will, to able to handle the big bodies. Right now, it's Jonathan Erickson and Dan DeKeyser, and they've formed a nice pairing. So, you know, with Quincy out, that hurts. Green coming back, it's going to be interesting to see how the pairings net out the next game.
Yeah, we think Mike Green will play on Sunday afternoon at Joe Louis Arena, and it's Bone Spurs that have taken Quincy out of the lineup now because the concussion has cleared. Well, there's no postgame for us tonight because we'll take you right to the Pistons out west, but late in tonight's game, we'll single out a Red Wing as the McDonald's Player of It. See if your pick matches ours. The process presented by the all-day breakfast menu only at McDonald's. Hockey people consider the chance to play in Toronto the Holy Grail. There's one Leaf who didn't think it would happen, even after the team had drafted him. We'll tell that story next as we continue here on a Friday night. Red Wings Live on Fox Sports Detroit is brought to you by your local Toyota dealers. Visit buyatoyota.com. Toyota, let's go places. And by Priority Health, Michigan's healthier approach to healthcare. Wings and Leafs coming up on this Friday night. He was drafted by the Leafs and yet didn't play for them until this year. And someone with way too much time on his or her hands computed that there were 5,000 plus days between that night that Brad Boyes was selected by Toronto and when he finally scored for them. He scored 43 goals for St. Louis a few years back and yet had to make the Leafs on a professional tryout this year. It's quite a story of hanging in there. And Trev's back with it for us from T.O. T.
Yeah, John, Brad Boyes grew up in Mississauga. It's probably 20 minutes from where he grew up to right here at the Air Canada Centre. And he grew up always wanting to play for the Leafs and thought that dream had come true back in 2000 when they took him 24th overall in the first round. But it didn't happen until this year. 11 seasons later and six teams later, he's finally come full circle but couldn't be more happy about his experience.
It's been awesome. It's been great. You know, obviously the results aren't what we want to do on the ice, but as far as being at home, being around our family, being available for holidays and things like that, family gatherings, it's great because I haven't been able to do that in a long time. So I'm enjoying it. I'm enjoying being around here and what comes with it.
Did you ever think it would come full circle for you like this?
I don't know. I'm getting older, and you never know. I bounced around a few times, but never here. And it was something that I just didn't know. You know what I mean? I was, you know, hopefully I was expecting to be in Florida last year, but and staying there because I enjoyed it and I liked where the team was going, but come here, it's worked out well. You know, I've enjoyed being here and get a chance to play finally at home.
Boyes comes into the rematch against the Red Wings here tonight, riding a hot hand. He's got 4 points in his last six games. He'll look to build on that in front of family and friends here at the Air Canada Centre tonight, John.
Yeah, we just need to get him a lozenge. All right, Trev, thanks. We'll rejoin you at the Air Canada Centre in just a matter of moments. All right, for you fantasy players, time for tonight's picks. Sponsored by DraftKings.
Well, why wouldn't I start with Mrazek? He's the other half of the best tandem in the National Hockey League right now. Hasn't played a poor game since turning pro in my estimation, so why not take the young goaltender?
All right, take Brent Seabrook against the Devils. It's that second wave of scoring, and he's been carrying the mail back there for the Blackhawks with Duncan Keith out.
I'm going to go with the guy everybody knows in Dallas, Klingberg. This guy's actually a stud defenseman. He's got 13 points this year, and he averages over 23 minutes of ice a game. Look out for this guy on Sunday when he invades the zone.
Up front, I got Corey Perry, scored his first goal. Sidney Crosby always puts on a show in Edmonton.
I got Sagan, and he'll be here Sunday too when Dallas invades the Joe, and he's a very good player as well. Ex-Plymouth Whaler.
All right, very good. Play one-day fantasy hockey for huge cash prizes on DraftKings.com, the official one-day fantasy sports partner of the Detroit Red Wings. Play free with promo code FLOAT. It was as if Edmonton won the Powerball, and it became some kind of a cruel joke. Never mind. The injury to Connor McDavid changes this hockey season. A little perspective on that next. All of a sudden, Edmonton lost its breath. It's our look around the league brought to you by Xfinity. When Connor McDavid lost an edge and crashed into the backboard the other night, it was apparent that it was potentially serious. It became actually serious with a diagnosis of a broken collarbone that will keep him out of the Oilers lineup for months. And the guy known as McSavior is McShelled. We saw the kid up close in Edmonton a couple of weeks ago. He's made exactly the kind of splash expected of him, but this is dreadful for hockey.
It is. You lose a star player, a marquee player, a kid that was really living up to advanced billing, which is hard to do just in 12 games. But for the Edmonton Oilers, they're going to have to get through it because they're supposed to be about much more than an 18-year-old hockey player.
And poor Edmonton, this has happened before. They lost Hall the year before due to bad injuries. This is their first overall pick. Eberle's always been hurt, and now this happens. And this kid was obviously a star, but I was shocked at how good he is at such a young age. This guy was dominating games and making moves that a lot of kids at his age just can't make. Generational player, off the charts, this kid. Unfortunate for Edmonton.
Yeah, and this was to be the year that they wouldn't have to worry about who to pick number one overall for a change. McDavid and Dylan Larkin related the stories of playing against each other since they were about 12 or 13 years of age. Well, we're only 20 minutes or so into a season, but Larkin is making a case that he perhaps is in the Calder Trophy conversation.
Yeah, I think you hear whispers around the league and amongst people in the media about how he could possibly have an opportunity to win this award. I mean, he's got 9 points up until this point, but I'm most impressed, he's plus 10. I mean, this guy's 200-foot game is crazy for his age, and he just plays the game the right way, Darren. And I don't see him slowing down. He's playing with Zetterberg. When Pavel Datsyuk gets back, he's getting an opportunity to play with one of the best players in the world. So I don't see his point total ever stopping. I know he's a rookie, he's a young guy. At some point, he's going to hit the wall. But I see him probably finishing. I mean, it might be a little high, 60 points, maybe 70 at best.
Wow.
But just what I've seen so far is he plays the game the right way. And that's why he's going to get to that point.
He does. Plus 10 leads all rookies, which is you might expect. But 60 points.
I said 60 at the lowest, 70 at the highest. I don't want to put too much pressure on
him. He's backpedaling already.
I mean, let's be honest. I mean, to me, Connor McDavid could still win the Rookie of the Year Award when he comes back, I mean, from his broken clavicle. But this is the year of rookies that you haven't heard of either. I mean, we know Jack Eichel's going to be in that mix.
Sure.
Dylan Larkin, maybe to a lot of people, is one of those guys who just burst on the scenes. But how about you got the two kids out in Phoenix?
Domi and Anthony Duclair. These guys are playing great. Max Domi, obviously, the son of former Ty Domi, who played for the Leafs, and everybody will know him fighting Bob Probert. But this kid has a heck of a lot more talent than his father did.
Sure
He's
does.
A stud player, and Phoenix is. To have these two kids right now might save their franchise.
You got Artemi Paranen. Paranen? Is that his name?
I can't
Oscar
read
Lindberg,
I can't read your writing
Parenko,
any better than you
and
can.
And Nikolai Ehlers. I mean, they're guys that you haven't really heard much about.
It's an infusion of youth.
Right, and they're having good starts to the season. Does that mean they're going to win the Rookie of the Year? Probably not.
It's all just to make us feel a little bit older behind this desk. Justin Abdelkader still youthful.
Panarin!
He may be hoping the reunion sparks something. No, it's too late. It's past. It's been crickets for him since he opened the season with a hat trick against Toronto. It's now the second game against their old head coach, and we'll talk of the change of temperament. We'll become like that. Wings Live on Fox Sports Detroit, brought to you by ZotAuto.com, home of Chrysler, Jeep, Dodge, Ram, Ford, Toyota, and Scion. A look at the storied names inducted into the Hall of Fame on Monday as Toronto celebrates them all weekend long. Well, Magic Mike isn't just the name of one of Chris Osgood's favorite movies. It's also the change that the new coach of the Maple Leafs was to bring to them. Yet on opening night in Detroit, the Red Wings ruled. And now in the second meeting, it's not quite so personal. It's another game between two longtime rivals, and Trevor's back with more on the shift in approach, but perhaps not in result. Trev?
Well, certainly opening night was a big one in Detroit this year when the Red Wings shut out the Maple Leafs 4-0 and looked darn good doing it. What the Leafs, or what the, rather what the Wings are trying to do now is get back to that. They had a hot start, had a bit of a dry spell, and now they're back to the type of game they want to play. But that game on opening night is really what they're looking for tonight. I asked some of the guys earlier today, what about that night do you hope to take and put into today's game for the same results? Here was the answer.
I think we played with a lot of urgency, a little bit of desperation in our game. I think we were missing that for quite a bit there for some time, and then I think we got back to it a little bit the last few games here. I think we've been playing better since the last three games, but we've still got some ways to go and learn from it. But I think that game we came out and we just a lot of energy and yeah, ready to go.
I think we've improved throughout the course of the year, and I think sometimes that's shown in results, sometimes it hasn't. But you know, we need to continue to get better. Our focus is trying to get better every day. I think we've taken steps in that direction. The other part of it, though, is to make sure you grab points along the way and earn as many points as possible. Points are critical in this league. It's so tight. Every game is so tight. Tonight will be the same thing. It's going to be an extremely hard game. We're going to have to go out and execute at a high level just to give ourselves the best chance. The win doesn't guarantee a win. So we're going to have to keep our focus. We're going to have to make sure we're playing extremely hard and extremely smart.
Jeff Blashill likes the way his team is coming along right now, but Mike Babcock feels the same way about his team. He thinks they're playing good hockey, they're getting better, even though the results aren't there. So expect a more tightly contested contest here at the Air Canada Centre tonight between the Leafs and the Wings. Keats, back to you inside the studio with the boys for now.
All right, Trev, thanks. Should be great fun at the Air Canada Centre. The game tonight is just the start of the party in Toronto. We need more ice. Takes on a whole new meaning. Ozzy and Darren with some thoughts on why the Wings Hall of Famers were so special. Next. On any trip to the Hall of Fame, there are going to be nights like this one when Sergei Fedorov owned the Joe Louis Arena ice. It was the day after Christmas in 96, a night that Caps goalie Jim Carrey wants to forget. Fedorov scored five times that night, including the overtime game winner in a 5-4 win. Nick Lidstrom's value to the Wings wasn't chiefly scoring goals, although he regularly did, but if he wondered if he'd experienced this, and late in his career, he finally picked up his first career hat trick. Three slappers from distance, the last with an empty net on December 15th, 2010 against the Blues in a 4-0 Detroit win. Which is the perfect timing to remind you that if a present-day Red Wing were to have a hat trick tonight, you can bring a copy of the box score into Arby's tomorrow for a free small order of curly fries. John and Darren and Ozzy back with you, and Chris Osgood played for 14 years with one Nick Lidstrom. We know him to be the perfect human. What was he like as a teammate?
It was the exact same, really. I mean, when he played, he reminded me, you know, he ran the power play like Peyton Manning, runs the offense, and he has the elegance and makes it look easy like Roger Federer does in tennis. Very few players at this level playing against the best players in the world make it look easy, and he was one of those guys. On the ice, it was ridiculous. Whenever we got in trouble, I would either cover it, which would be my second option. First would be give it to Nick Lindstrom because I knew he'd get it out. And it was just crazy how good he was. And to me, he's one of the few guys that's retired that I think could still play. I really didn't think he fell off that much at the end of his career. He was great. He could run a power play like nobody else. I think that's what you've seen with the Red Wings. You're never going to replace him, but you can't replace a guy that can run a power play like that.
Elegance, what a word to describe an athlete. Yeah. And for me, it was graciousness. As a broadcaster, he put the Conn Smythe Trophy on the dasher boards here at Joe Louis Arena in 2002 and did a radio interview with me when he didn't have to. I'll always remember that.
It was really cool watching video today because you're reminded how good Nick Lidstrom and Sergei Fedorov were in their prime, especially with the Russian five-man. It was choreography.
It really was. It was trend-setting in the National Hockey League. Sergei Fedorov, for me, Matthew Dandonneau playing defense and forward was something. When he moved back and played defense, he did look like the best defenseman in the game.
I mean, this guy, there's very few guys you could say are a complete player in the National Hockey League. This guy was. He could play defense like no other, and he was great offensively. To me, should have stayed a Red Wing. It's a shame the way it did end, I think, or his jersey would for sure be in the Raptors. Maybe one day it will be, but this guy was one of the greatest Red Wings to ever play.
All right, those guys are going to be honored on the ice at the Air Canada Centre tonight. You've heard from them. You'll hear more from them on Sunday. But stay with us during the intermissions tonight because we're happy to be joined by a longtime Red Wing fan and a pretty good hockey player in his own right.
Oh, that's pushing it. That is pushing it.
The right actor, there. The comedian, the impressionist, Dave Coulier. He'll be with us after the first and after the second around our coverage of the Wings and the Leafs. The Toronto Next, Ken and Mick will join you after a break here on Fox Sports Detroit.